Session about public spaces and feminism and women's role and how other and what are the exclusions generally in the public spaces. Just maybe a couple of words about my background. I studied international relations, which is not really important because I worked in that. But then from university I got engaged in an NGO with human rights and democracy as a volunteer, and since 2008 I've been involved in social movements and activist groups. Yesterday you met people who were doing mining, in mining struggles. You heard about Telhut and Terchikan and maybe about Marshall Park. So I was part of those movements, first from environmental and mining, and then public spaces were really interesting for me. Mainly I was involved in public parks protection. Then, after several years, it was really a stage of burnout came. I don't know if you have had that yourself. Then when I came back, my priority interest was more with women's issues and feminism. So now I'm sort of connecting feminism and public spaces. Okay, we can already move to the next slide. So these are just two pictures of public spaces in Yerevan to show that the city itself was constructed during the Soviet period. Historically, it's much older, but the way you will see it today, it was in the 20s and up to the 60s. A lot of parks, a lot of open spaces for the public use, large pavements, etc. The Soviet Union was collapsed, the situation totally changed. We can move to the next slide. In the Soviet period, there was nothing public, it was all private, managed by the state, and of course free of charge, everything. The post-Soviet period came with neoliberalism, neoliberal capitalism. And what happened, that time was large privatization of the whole public sector. And it's not only about spaces, it's the whole probably, like most of you know, because you have some background from either Soviet countries or associate. The whole public sector collapsed, all the factories were closed or shut down. What happened to public spaces, first they were totally abandoned, because the population there was extreme poverty and the people didn't really care about what's happening outside their houses. So the same parks which looked really pretty and cared for in the 60s, 70s and 80s looked something like this already in the 90s. But this abandonment, it didn't last for long because the states didn't care about it and the citizens did not self-organize to do something in the public space. So then the private sector came in and decided to get some profit from what used to be a public space. In the first picture you see the opera area, which is really in the very center of the city. And in the first picture you had the big garden and free space next to it. This became like everything which was free space was perceived to be non-useful space which can be taken over. So a lot of businesses like cafes, restaurants and other paid activities took these spaces, not only near the opera but in all the public parks. The pavements were privatized virtually. Every step you make in Yerevan, you are stepping on someone's private property. It's really hard to find any public property in the city any longer, unfortunately. The next slide, please. It will be just a picture of the green areas in the city. Of course, like parks and green areas are not the only public spaces, but this gives quite a picture. In the 90s, there were 73% of green area in Yerevan. It shrank already in 2003, there was 43%, and in 2007, 29%. This data is from Transparency International. They are making surveys from time to time about the green areas in the city. And of course, the shrinking of green areas is a result of also the privatization and the construction work. Like you are going to visit one of the bigger parks in the city later today, and it used to be something like a forest, and then two big hotels were built also in the space where this so whole forest area was. Well, the people, I would say that the local population always disliked this privatization because like people had their forest, people had their parks and they could walk them, and suddenly at some point they have to pay for being there, they have to pay for a cafe. And it's not only being the issue of making payment, it's also somehow being not welcome in a space. If you don't look in a way, if you're not in a class which would represent the majority of people being there, etc., etc. But there was no resistance, I would say, until almost recently. So it was since 2005 on, there started small movements for public spaces, but it was not formulated as public space. At that time, they were more groups of architects who wanted to preserve their old cultural heritage, which was being destroyed for the new style of buildings and or for shopping areas, this kind of thing. So I just put this picture there. This is called Open Air Hall of Moscow Cinema, and it's considered to be one of the good architectural pieces of the 60s, and one of the bigger, like to say, movement resistances about protecting architectural heritage was about protecting this cinema. The state wanted to make a big church there because there used to be a church somewhere nearby before the Soviets, and it was really a hard struggle because church is really a difficult institution here, but they managed well, and the cinema was preserved. So one area where the civil resistance was organized, it was for protecting the cultural heritage and the architectural buildings. The next slide, please. This is about, so the parks were one area, the architectural heritage was the second area, the third, fifth area where there was resistance was in the public courtyard, and I think some of you were saying about it. In Yerevan and a lot of other towns, the buildings will have a huge area, which is huge or not huge, which is for common use, and it will be for children to play, for all ages and generations to do some kind of activity there. But after the second privatization stage in the 2000s, now the private company started to take these spaces in the courtyards and make either some kind of buildings there or like sports centers, so some kind of paid private activities there. And there were, still are, some groups fighting for that, usually like grassroots neighborhood groups. Next slide. The first time where actually we started in Yerevan, started to claim public space and naming it public space, it was only 2 years ago, in 2012. Before that, there had been also fights for public space protection or shaping public spaces, designing public spaces. But it was only in 2012 in Moscow's Park that the activists and the people who were fighting for it started to name it a public space, to raise the issue that this is a space where it's for everyone, and also we don't want it to be designed by someone sitting in the mayor's office to decide what to do in a public space. We want as citizens to self-organize, to structure, to shape our own public spaces. And also there was raised the issue of public property versus private property, because our municipality was very strongly standing for the rights of the private property owners. So the activists were then coming and what about the public property, why should it be less important? And also in this period we see, like in the public spaces, the first action organized by women, which was not at that time a feminist action at all, but it was from that point on already some women groups started to organize for also doing like women's rights oriented or feminist oriented actions in the public spaces. It was so this Marshall's Park issue is about a public park where the municipality decided to build a shopping area, and the protest was to keep the park and to make it keep it as a public space and not want to have the shops there. The shops were already like partially constructed there. On March 8th of 2012, the women activists decided to occupy these half-constructed boutiques and to demand that there were fences, that they are dismantled and the construction stops. And actually, like, it was a kind of secret operation, and it worked well. The women they were not expecting it on March 8th, and were not expecting it from women. And I will tell you later, it was really like how the police, the state, generally, this patriarchal dominated institution, they don't know how to react when women are doing something in the public space. So, they didn't want to be harsh, and then when we were already inside, the chief police came. It was a non-working day, so they were at home. And he came, he couldn't think of anything better than buying the flowers and deposing the flowers to the women who were in the occupation. Can we move to the next slide? And I want to speak very briefly about what kind of how the public space. How patriarchal domination is in the public space. So a few points like symbols in the symbolic. You walk in the city and you see statues, you see advertisement, you see graffiti, and what do you see there? I'll show some pictures later on, but at least if you walk in the cities of Yerevan and in many, many other places where I've been, you see statues of kings and heroes on the horses. For a woman, it's really difficult to find and associate yourself with the visual stuff that is in the city. Either women are nameless, so it's like, you know, nice women naked standing somewhere. Sometimes there are also queens, okay, but that's a rare exception. In the advertisement, we would see objectified sexist advertisements usually. Graffiti is different, but also a lot of macho-style graffiti, at least in the streets of Yerevan and in many other places. Second point about the structure, everywhere in the world, the urban construction is also very male-dominated. And the architecture, the whole urban construction, it also doesn't consider so much the needs of women, just like one short example, that you don't usually have breastfeeding places, for example, in the cities, or places where which would be people who would have disabilities, or women still do a lot of the childcare. So if they walk with these cars, they are not really accustomed to that, and just also the looks and many other issues. At the verbal level, for a woman walking in the street, and I would like to say that speaking about public spaces, it's not only about the physical space. It's also the, let's say, the social media space where there are public discussions. It's also all the level where people can interact and form their relations, start, put new agendas. So at the verbal level, this is also very clear, not only in the streets, but also in the social media, through the media. We see this patronizing and abusive language, babies, doggy, etc., or a lot of curses. If something is going on, always the curses are offending women. On the verbal level also, it's connected with maybe the next point, the visibility and the media. When there are public actions, then usually it's the men who are holding the microphone, unless it's like women's rights actions, generally. Not in all cases, of course, but it's men who get the media attention, who get the microphones, who get the loud speech. There is this protection and care thing that women are usually tried, not in all contexts, but generally there's this tendency of domesticating women. So women would be encouraged to stay at home. Public spaces, especially some spaces after certain hours, are called to be dangerous. So women cannot go everywhere whenever they want. Perception, women's actions in the public space, I already mentioned before, they are very often considered as something lifestyle, not important, not serious. Okay, girls are having fun. Again, at a different level, but at the public space, women are much more likely to have their private personal space violated. For example, you're sitting somewhere in the bench and others feel free to come and start talking to you. You're sitting in a, even not in a public space, like in a bar and cafe, it's even more. But this is another, or observing what the woman is wearing and how she's moving. These are also really destructive things which we, it is good to think about in the public space. These were, of course, not an exhaustive list, and this was a lot focused on women issues in the public space, but there are a lot of other exclusions for a lot of other groups. Maybe you have in mind a few, what other groups can be excluded or discriminated in the public space?